So there are, because this is a dialectical culture, the same science has been expressed in story forms. I cannot go into the whole story, it's a long story. But when I told this story to one of the top scientists in the world, when I was speaking to him and I explained this, see, this is how it is, this is the nature of the existence. This is from the yogic lore, but we are always told not to believe the lore till it becomes a reality in your experience. And this is the reality in my experience. If you go like this, this is what will happen. So when I spoke to this very top-level scientist, who's a Nobel laureate, and I was telling him that this is what it is, there were a group of… Hello? There was a group of them, and when I explained, this is how it is within me, what do you think? They said, Sadhguru, if you can give a mathematical backbone to what you're talking, this is Nobel Prize stuff. Can you give a mathematical background?
And so we'll make a boundary, we'll call it a finite boundary, this is a circle, and it encloses a certain volume, right? It could be a sphere in the space, so don't reduce it necessarily to a circle. And then inside it, we're going to put an equilateral triangle. Now that triangle in a sphere could be a tetrahedron. Everybody knows what a tetrahedron is? It's one of these, right? And we can polarize that tetrahedron because the universe has spin. Things spins in the universe, and when there's spin, there's polarity. So it's okay, you can polarize it. So you can polarize the triangle. And interestingly, right away, you got an ancient symbol that you can find in many, many different cultures all around the world, although it's best known by the Jewish culture as the Star of David or the Star of Zion. Well, if you look carefully, you find that as soon as I polarized the first tetrahedron, I created new boundaries that have the exact same geometry that I started with. Except these boundaries are one step smaller, right? They're one gradient or one iteration smaller. Well, what's important to remember here is that each of these boundaries define a very specific center, right? Like this boundary here, this is its center and this is its center. And all of the centers are all different from all other centers. That means that each of the boundary, although they are part of a similar geometry that is interactive with each other, meaning one cannot exist without the other ones, they all have their own very specific coordinates in space-time, and they observe the rest of the fractal structure from its own very specific point of view that no other boundary in the system has. You all following this? It's an important point. Now, you can polarize those, and you'll get smaller boundaries again. And again, each one is a very individual boundary. And you polarize those, you get smaller ones, and you know, you can go to infinity doing that. So if I had this program running on my computer, it could keep zooming in and making more boundary and zooming in and making more boundaries, and it would go to infinity. Like, as long as the computer was running, it would keep going. However, I would never, ever, ever, ever escape or exceed the first boundary I've made for myself. So within the context of a finite space, I've embedded infinite amount of information, infinite amount of divisions. That means that if this is true, and you know, if it's geometrically true, And if it's mathematically true, then most likely is true. You could take the boundary of any of your atoms or the boundary of your cells and divide them and divide them and divide it to infinity, meaning that you have an infinite amount of information, an infinite amount of divisions within yourself. So all of a sudden, you're starting to have a mechanical and mathematical understanding of the infinite nature of your existence. It's no longer just a metaphysical concept. It's no longer a belief or a dogma. It's actually a mathematical equation.
They said, Sadhguru, if you can give a mathematical backbone to what you're talking, this is Nobel Prize stuff. Can you give a mathematical background? I said, I'll never bother about the mathematics. It's true for me and it has transformed everything that I am because it's true for me. Everything that I ever was changed simply because I touched this dimension within me. I don't wish to work equations for that. And anyway, Nobel Prize wouldn't mean anything to me. I would be too embarrassed by such things.
They found or they seem to have found something near to what they are referring to as God particle. You know this? It's called the boson, which has a mass which is of a certain significance. If you try to look at the whole universe, you will not see anything. If you just look at an atom intensely enough, and if the atom yields to you, then you know how the whole universe is made. Now they are no more talking about atom. They were talking about subatomic particles. Now they are not even talking about that. When two subatomic particles collide, not atoms, when two protons collide, something spills out of that. They want to see that. But when you say, I am on the path of yoga, you're not even interested in the tiny minuscule particle. You want to see the empty space which holds all this in place. That is their desire also, but they kind of given up on it.
And the space inside the atom is 99.99999%. So maybe we should pay attention to the largest percentage instead of the smallest percentage. We spend a lot of time paying attention to the 0.00000001% that we call matter, and we spend very little time paying attention and trying to understand the 99.999999% of the space.
That's their desire also, that they want to see what is it that's holding all this together. But they understand, they're sensible enough to understand, with these two eyes, with these senses, we can't see it. The only way is to go to the nearest point and see it. The nearest point is as far as away as Timbuktu. You understand? Right now, I don't know if you're interested in these things, but you must know these things because it's got a very direct relationship with yogic system. There was a time when scientists believed, they thought, let's say if this is an atom, big enough for you to see? Okay. If this is an atom, proton, neutron, electron are all embedded in it like these dots. They thought it was like that. Then by the time you came to high school, they wrote a different picture. They wrote one central circle which contains proton, neutron, and electrons are going around like planets in different formats. Yes, you've seen those pictures? But now they know it's completely wrong. and we have always known it's completely wrong. That's why textbooks never ever interested me, because when I look at it, it looked dumb. Today, suppose this is the size of the core of the atom. The electrons are, let's say, somewhere approximately a mile away. That's the kind of distance.
The densest atom is like, a molecule is a, you know, a diamond molecule. If you grew one of the atom in that molecule, the other one would be 2 football fields away if the one you grew was the size of an orange. That's how much space there is in between them, and then the space inside the atom is 99.99999%.
You understand? Within an atom. An atom is not like this. No human being has ever seen an atom. Do you know this? Forget about a proton, neutron, electron. Nobody has ever witnessed an atom. Even in a super electron microscope, you cannot see it. In that, there is a housing where proton, neutrons are there, and the electrons are about a mile away in comparison, in proportion, I'm saying. So what is the maximum substance in this? Emptiness, isn't it?